BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
Ah, good. You're here. Absolutely on time. Right. Yeah, have you got your case with you? Well, at least a toothbrush and some toothpaste and stuff like that, yes? Good. Because tonight, if you remember, we're going to catch the Wireless Knights Express into adventure. I'll paint the picture for you. Yes, we're here at Euston Station in London. You can probably hear the hustle and the bustle of things going around. I'm looking at a train to the left of me, and it says on the blue painted side of the train, Caledonian Sleeper. I don't know how much sleep we're going to get, but we're going to get on that train, and that's going to drive us through the night up into Scotland.
It's a very good way to encounter people that are difficult to encounter normally. There's always the sense that you're going to discover something new.
Good evening, how are you?
I'm all right, thank you.
You're ready for the journey tonight?
I don't know if I'm ready, but I'm willing.
Well, that's all you need.
You don't know what's going to happen to you, and you don't know who you're going to talk to, you don't know who you're going to meet. All those things are a mystery still, and they always give you the hope that they'll surprise you, that something new is there, and it very often is.
Right, we are coach E, 3 and 4. So here we are. Here's number 3. And you're next door there, yes, see, you've got your own cabin, you'll be glad to know about that. I mean, you know, we're friends, but not that close, are we? Or are we? Right, and it seems to be locked. How do you open this? I think there's a special... Oh, I was pulling instead of pushing, as usual.
I caught myself a midnight train. I beat my way into Texas.
Okay, so here we are. We've got the bed down here. So let's, you know, put my suitcase on this shelf here. And get some of my stuff out and try and make it look a bit homely.
And I'll never see my girl again, oh Lord. I'll never see my girl again.
Very narrow corridor, and we're walking past lots of doors. Who knows what's going on behind those doors? And here we are, Caledonian Sleeper lounge car. Let's go and have a look. See, it's quite full in here already. Look, there's a spare table over there. Get it quick. One thing about being in one of these dining cars is you can't help but kind of look around and see what other people are up to on the other tables. Obviously, some people are drinking. Some people are playing games, I'm sure. Looking over there, look. Well, don't make it obvious, but pretend that you're...
What I'm trying to say is, there's a man over there who looks a lot like David Bowie. Which reminds me that the Thin White Duke did travel a lot by train. From station to station, back in the day.
David wasn't keen on flying for quite a while.
Here's a friend of his, Geoff MacCormack. He knows.
The Trans-Siberian Express came up, and we thought it was a great idea. So there we were. We boarded a wonderful train, beautiful train. It was a French-built Tsarist train, and it was all mahogany and brass and tassels, and even the toilet chain was of tassel, silk, and white tablecloths, and it was gorgeous. And we thought, well, this is going to be wonderful. However, the next morning, we pulled into another station, and we were all herded onto a plastic train with formica and Not so sexy at all. David was making a transition from a very hard-working and hungry artist knocking at the door to someone who was now in it, big time. We were dressed what would be considered to well, anybody, let alone Russians, pretty effeminate. David had very red hair. I had rather smart, dark red boots and bellish bottom trousers. From time to time, we were joined by a photographer, and he was just fabulous, you know, and I think was even more effeminate than we were. And he had snakeskin boots, as I remember, and they were kind of yellow. But we must have been quite freaky to Russians. The kind of clothing we had wasn't functional as such. It was more for style, which was kind of regrettable, really, because it was pretty cold.
I think what you're wearing tonight is very fetchy, actually. But I do hope that you've brought some proper walking shoes with you for our hike in the Highlands.
Right, so the food has arrived. Obviously, I'm not going to talk with my mouth full, right? So,
how about a bit of a read while we're eating? I brought my book.
Ooh! There seems to be some problem with the power in this carriage, and it keeps going dark. And I'm looking at the people on the table opposite, and I'm thinking next time the light goes off and then when it comes back on, one of them may be murdered or something like that. You never know what can happen on a train at night.
Now we're all right. It's been like a bit of a power failure.
Yeah, we've had a power failure in there, yeah.
I guess you have to stay awake all night, don't you?
Yeah.
And when it gets to, like, the middle of the night, I would find it a bit spooky.
There was one time, it was a coach at the end of the train that was empty because the lights wasn't working on it, and it was completely dark, and I had to go back and pin back all of the doors. So I opened the doors, pinned them back against the wall, and I'm at the very back of the train, so there isn't another host for about three or four coaches pinning back doors in this darkened train.
I wouldn't have done that.
No, I didn't mind it too much, so...
I guess Matthew's what you might call a night owl. Actually.
I was in Guangzhou, Canton, where in the food markets they sell anything.
Colin Thubron is a well-known travel writer and has been capturing the mysterious quality of rail travel for years.
And there were monkeys and everything to be eaten, but it was fresh. In other words, the monkeys were alive. The cats and kittens they were eating were alive. I came in particular, I remember, on a stall of beautiful owls, and there was this gorgeous barn owl. I love owls. And I couldn't bear it. I bought this barn owl in order to set it free rather than to eat it. And we spent that day in Guangzhou with this poor owl in a carrier bag, wondering how to get rid of him. I got onto a train that night and waited until night fell. I was in a carriage full of other pompous-looking officials, and I didn't know what to do. The owl was also smelling rather badly, and they didn't know where the smell was coming from, so I was already unpopular. After about midnight, when I thought the carriage was nicely asleep, I opened the window and let this beautiful owl out into the night. It went out like a great white moth into the dark. And then I turned around and saw that the most important of the officials had his eyes wide open, was looking at me in complete disdain. You know, this mad foreigner had thrown a five-star meal into the night. And he thought it was completely, completely potty.
Not potty at all, Colin. More like heroic.
So one thing, we are on a sleeper train, and I know we've been having a good time, but at the risk of sounding like the party pooper, Why don't we go and find our cabins again and have a bit of a lie down? Yeah? Can you remember which carriage we're in, please? You sure? I thought it was...
I know where I'm going, and I know who's going with me.
I'm trying to find my toothpaste in here. You can. Right, so I found the toothpaste, got the brush.
Somehow seems to make brushing your teeth a little bit more exciting knowing that you're doing it while speeding through the countryside.
Scenery of Miss Webster's journey from Manchester to Isle of Killoran, Scotland.
Right, so here we are in the cabin. Things off the bed. So I'm going to let the gentle, relaxing motion of the train lull me to sleep. That's the idea, anyway. Time is 1:20 in the morning. And still here, I don't know if you can hear, there's people moving around up and down the corridors. I guess some people have decided to turn in for the night, and other people are deciding they're going to party all the way up to the Highlands. And in fact, reminds me of a story somebody once told me about a train that was designed especially for partying.
My name is Tessa. I'm Dutch. I'm from Rotterdam. I got an invitation to come to Hungary, but it was really last minute. I think it was only a week before, so I didn't arrange any flights or things like that. And when I was behind a computer looking for flights, I was like, oh, darn, where's my passport? So I was trying to find my passport for the next hours, and I didn't find it. So I was a bit hesitant in booking a flight. Then I found about this train. It's a special train, a Sziget Express, that leaves from Holland and goes directly to Budapest. And I figured, like, if I don't have a passport, it wouldn't be that bad. At least I can book a ticket. So that's what I did. I booked a ticket for the Sziget Express. I didn't know very well what to expect, and I was just, okay, this is going to be an interesting 20 hours. And it turned to be a very interesting 20 hours indeed.
Now, I've heard the word Sziget before. It's the name of a music festival on the outskirts of Budapest. So this train might be a bit lively.
All aboard the night train!
It was just one party from the start on. The station was just packed with young kids in groups, people already dressed in their party outfits, like onesies and crazy hats, and already drinking. And I was about in my 30s at that point, and like the festival goers are mostly like 18, like for the first time away from their parents and just, you know, like, let's not sleep, being able to do whatever they wanted and get drunk. I booked a first class ticket. So when I got to the train, I was like, oh, at least I can get some sleep and not be amongst all these party people. Then I got to the train and it was just all second class. It was all the same, so that there was no first class. Basically, it would be just sitting in your chair for 20 hours and there was no space for even your feet. That was the first bump in the road.
And just when you thought it couldn't get any worse,
soon on the train, this guy next to us just starts playing his ukulele. And after 15 minutes, it's like, he's not changing the song. It just keeps on playing Over the Rainbow. It wasn't really pretty either. I think he just bought it 2 days early or something, and he just started playing it.
After we transferred from the beautiful Mahogany Train to the rather naff Formica Train, the journey became quite boring. For David, people recognised him in the cities, but not so much on board. I think that the way we travelled in between tours and the madness were good for him to set him up for the next batch. We used to drink with soldiers who were quite young. They were some of them in their teens. Neither of us spoke each other's language, but when you get terribly drunk, those things don't seem to matter quite as much. Actually, looking at the trip as a whole and some of the bleakness of what we saw in Siberia and how people lived, and I think that very much must have influenced future writing, say Diamond Dogs, say Station to Station. So I think the slowness of the travel in between the touring was quite useful.
It's about 2 a.m. now. I'm not sure. You can probably tell there's not much noise in the background. I think that the train has stopped for some reason. I'm not sure why. We stopped. I'm looking out of the window now, and it's completely deserted. Also looks like it's been raining a little bit. I'm glad to be here in this warm cabin rather than out there in the rain. But Colin, on a night very much like this, did decide to get off the train.
The landscape was wood. It was this forested landscape. It's mostly larch and silver birch. It's enormous. Almost a quarter of the forest of the whole earth is there in Siberia. And we arrived at the end of this, not far from the Amur River in the southeast Siberia, and the train just stopped. I got out. It was absolute nightfall. You get off in the night and there's absolutely no sign of where you might stay. The train sort of reversed back, and I remember this coordinates of the people who, usually a woman who is in charge of the compartments, just, I said, you know, is there anywhere to sleep here? And she said, no, no. And just as the train was disappearing, she said, and there are wolves. That's very cheerful. I can remember it fading away into the forest, saying, and there are wolves. I can't remember how long I was walking for, maybe a mile something. Long enough to begin to feel anxious. And I was following the railway track, which kind of petered out.
Probably here. The train has started moving again. Night.
I didn't want to watch too much on how late it was because time was just passing slow. Holland, it started, and well, then probably just Germany and of course Austria. It passed by Austria as well, and then Hungary, but I'm not sure if we also passed through Luxembourg or France. And the guy playing the ukulele the whole time on the same song and the first two notes. It just kept on going forever. It must have been 100, I don't know. And then every coupe had its own sound system. There was also this coupe where there was a party going on, so there was this bar where they sold beers, and there was a DJ. imagine all these drunk 18-year-olds just taking over the train at the time too regularly, because then you just realize that it takes forever. Please don't play this song anymore.
It's 5:36 a.m. The train is still moving. I'm just going to have a look out the window. Hold on. I've no idea where the train is now. We're travelling.
You'll take the high road and I'll take the low road.
What do you think about the Scotland countryside outside the window?
Next station, Gretna Green.
What might be happening?
You're over the border now.
Travelling past houses, fields, animals, trees.
I was a bit worried by wolves. It's a bit like a sort of Russian fairy tale. Somewhere down the line, there was a little lit-up cabin there, and here was this little hut with this blonde giant sitting in it. Typical Russian folk hero-looking man with blonde moustaches and so on. I think he just thought I was a sort of Western ghost. He'd never... coming at night, too. He said, well, come back to me and my mum. So I went back to his tiny cottage stuck in the wilds there. There was absolutely no sign to begin with of any kind of accommodation. And this, in this case, was his mother who was looking at a television program. And this woman was quite captivated by it. And her son said, you know, there's no point in disturbing her. But I think that particular occasion was just an extreme version of something I've always found, which is eventually people will be helpful, particularly to the stray foreigner.
Yes. Things usually turn out all right in the end, don't they? We must be getting quite near our destination now. Let's start thinking about getting dressed.
Hello?
Hold on a minute. Typical, as soon as you start to do it.
We were approaching East Germany. This old boy, a big lump he was as well, who worked on the train, started banging on our door.
I know the feeling, Geoff.
These three people were standing there. Police. Apparently, we didn't have the right papers. So we didn't have the visas to go from east to west. So we were visa-less. David did look rather ashen, and we were told to stand in the corridor while the East German guards started to, like, kick doors in to see if there were people hiding or whatever. And we thought they were going to cart us off and take us off into jail in East Germany. I just thought they couldn't be bothered with a couple of freaks, and they just wanted to get rid of us and send us back to the West. And then we went through No Man's Land, which is the area between East and West, or was. And I remember that it was like the moon was shining, and there was, you could just see these bombed out relics with nobody around, and it just looked really quite desperate and horrible. To really emphasise the feeling, as we pulled into West Berlin station, the lights were suddenly really bright, and on the platform were these crowds of Ziggy kids in glitter and makeup and whatever, and it was just, whoa, we're home.
Yeah.
Well, we may not be home, but we are in Scotland. What? No Britpop-themed welcoming committee for me? Things have gone downhill since the 70s, haven't they? It's just as well, really. I mean, nobody looks their best at 6 in the morning, do they? But at least we got a bit of rest. Think about poor old Tessa.
Basically, my body and my mind were at 10% because I just couldn't handle anymore at that time. Like, I was just... Normally, when I get to a country, I'm like, oh, I want to see it, and I want to interact with the people, and like, oh, what's this? And let's get a sandwich. But right now, it was just, okay, I want to go to the apartment. I could barely call my friend and say, like, I'm here, just come and get me. And yeah, not something that was really my kind of drink, so to say.
Yeah, I mean, we got off lightly, if you think about it. But Oi, listen. What's that noise? There's another train pulling into the station. Listen. I don't believe this. It's only a rave train.
Oi! Oi, wait, where are you going? We're supposed to be going hiking, mate. Mate, come back.
Yeah, very funny. Yeah, you got me. Yeah. But seriously, I mean, we've already had an adventure, and we've only just arrived. I mean, who knows what's just around the corner? You did bring that map, didn't you? Oh, mate. It's okay. We'll just improvise. We'll see where we end up. I mean, it's safe up here, isn't it? It's not like there are any wolves around or anything, is it? Keep up, man. I'll take the high road and you'll take the low. I'll be in Scotland before ye.
BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.